thank you very much for coming. My name is Orgo Sengupta, and I'm the research director at the Vidhi Center. And we are really delighted today to have my good friend and accomplished lawyer. It's very hard to describe him because he's a man of many qualities, but so I'd like to stick with good friend, Vikram Raghavan. Vikram is here to talk to us about the Constituent Assembly debates. And the Constituent Assembly debates, if I may say, have made a resurgence as far as Supreme Court jurisprudence is concerned in recent years. In the last couple of years, there have been many significant judgments which have quoted heavily from the debates, which have relied on the debates to come to conclusions. Both the judgment on the judicial appointments case, the recent judgment on Arunachal, have both quoted the Constituent Assembly debates extensively, which is great for us constitutional scholars because it shows that the Constituent Assembly debates are really alive and well. Because I remember reading an article that Ronojoy Sen had written in the Times of India a while back, which had said and lamented actually that there's a lot written about the constitutional conventions in Philadelphia as well as in France, but very little written about the truly fascinating debates that we've had in the Constituent Assembly in India. And I'm hoping that there is a greater amount of literature on these debates that start. And as a beginning, I'm delighted that Vikram is here today, as in Vikram being both a lawyer with the World Bank as well as being a constitutional scholar with a great interest in Indian constitutional history, I think is the right person to continue to reignite interest in the Constituent Assembly debates. This talk is in keeping with Vidhi's aim of not just organizing talks on legal subjects for lawyers, but also for non-lawyers. And I'm very delighted that history students are also here today with us. So I think it would be, without any further ado, I'd hand over to Vikram with the caveat that he has expressly asked me to mention that he is here today in his personal capacity. One last point, we are all aware of the fact that there is a badminton finals that's on today at about 7 o'clock. So Vikram is going to speak for 45 minutes and we're going to have a short Q&A session after that so that at least we can hope to see some of that match and hopefully that ends well. Over to you, Vikram.
Can you hear me? Okay. Thank you, Orgo. This is a small room, so am I echoing? Yeah? Okay. Thank you for that generous income, and thank you, all of you, for coming out despite the match. I actually, as soon as my heart sank when he called me to tell me the news, but I'm happy if people want to leave for that. I'm glad, you know, you're here at least in the beginning. And also coming out on a Friday evening, a Delhi audience, I think, is the most intimidating audience for any speaker. And as I was explaining to someone I just met, that, you know, I think the multiple constituencies, and I think it's, you know, especially challenging to speak to a Delhi audience. And I'm grateful that I have that opportunity, especially since I don't live here. And I live in a city where, you know, we don't really have these sorts of events. But I wanted to mention that because late last year, I received a call from a diplomat at the Indian Embassy in Washington, and he asked me if I'd be willing to reprise my talk on Granville Austen, which took place last year, which Orgo kindly hosted, on the making of the Constitution. Now, justifiably, the embassy seemed quite unsure about the interest that this might generate, even though Granville Austen hailed from Washington. But so accordingly, to ensure a decent turnout, the embassy decided that my talk would be accompanied by a Carnatic concert of patriotic songs. I wasn't sure I could join in the singing, but I agreed on the condition that I would go first. As it turned out, the mics failed no sooner after I finished speaking. And so the minutes ticked by and the audience grew more restive. The one by one, the guests, my colleagues who were lawyers, sort of walked out, made their way through the door. And when the mics eventually revived, the singers, you know, hastily performed a song, and the event quickly drew to a close. As I left the dais, I noticed this young man who was waiting patiently for me. He introduced himself as the head of the local IIT chapter, and he wanted me to come to speak to the group, to his nerdy group. Why, I asked, would you be interested in me talking about the Indian Constitution? We made clear that that's what he was calling me about. Well, he said, quite nonchalantly, we are actually reading the Constituent Assembly debates. Now, this response left me truly startled. No lawyer I knew would be caught dead with the debates, right? Whether for fun or, you know, reluctantly for work. And here, engineers in Northern Virginia, in suburban Washington, were gathering to read these fat volumes as part of a book club. So I've been wondering long and hard what explains this remarkable interest in our founding debates among ordinary citizens. No ordinary citizens, but I think it's extraordinary that there's so much interest in India's founders, more interest than any other time before in our history. And that calls for some introspection about why and how we should be reading our founding debates. Now, my talk, I change the slides and the page. It's like being in a concert where you have an assistant on the page. My talk basically will begin our discussion with returning to my hometown to display this image of Madras University's Chepauk campus with its majestically ornate Senate House designed by the Scottish architect Chisholm. Into this campus in August 1951 walked a tall, elegantly attired European. No one quite knew who he was or what brought him there, and some thought he was French because of his accent. Some mistook him, others mistook him for a Jewish refugee. But he was neither. Charles Henry Alexandrowitz was born in Lviv, which is a city which is now in Ukraine, which was then part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And he was educated by Benedictine monks, and he later moved to Krakow. Pre-World War II Krakow, where he studied law and practiced briefly as a lawyer. When the Second World War began, he joined the Polish army, but the army was quickly decimated, as all of us know, and Alexandrowicz was one of the lucky ones who managed to escape and arrived in London, where he quickly associated himself with the Polish government in exile. After the war, he was called to the bar at Lincoln's Inn and began teaching international law at the University of London. Meanwhile, halfway around the world, A.L. Mudaliar, the longtime vice chancellor of Madras University, set up the country's first department of international and constitutional law in 1950. Mudaliar felt that the new republic needed well-trained lawyers in both subjects. Now, who actually selected Alexandrowicz to come to Madras remained a mystery until the last 24 hours. I just received word from, and I'm actually saying this is no joke, from Alexandrowicz's biographer, the Harvard historian, David Armitage, that Mudaliar actually took the trouble of constituting a search committee with the prominent British academics who recruited Alexandrowicz to lead the first Department of International and Constitutional Law in this country. So moving to Madras, Alexandrowicz quickly became a pioneer in Indian legal education and scholarship. He founded the so-called Madras School of Law, and he mentored a large number of Indian lawyers and thinkers, including the irrepressible Lily Thomas of the Supreme Court Bar. Some of you have seen her, I mean, you know, you've noticed her. I actually tried to get her in touch with, you know, his biographer, because there aren't that many of his students who are still around. But he also has, in a way, grandchildren in the law, because lots of people who weren't taught by him were taught by his students, who also sort of think of him as a mentor. Now, 6 years into his Madras tenure, the professor publishes a short monograph called Constitutional Developments in India. It is one of the first books on our constitution, and in it, Alexandrowicz offers three basic reasons why we must study India's constitutional debates. First, Alexandrowicz says, as a foundational document, the constitution cannot remain static. It needs to be constantly reinterpreted, and therefore consulting the debates can help adapt the text to each generation's changing needs. Second, despite its length, the Constitution is not the final word on many issues. For instance, the Constitution is silent about how the Prime Minister is to be selected. So Alexandrowicz argues that the Constituent Assembly here deliberately wanted to let constitutional practice take care of this question with guidance from the debates. Third, Alexandrowicz submits that the debates can prevent disputes between the legislature and the judiciary over the meaning of the Constitution. And by analyzing the framers' intentions, the two branches can avoid needless institutional friction. And this reduced institutional friction would basically bring down the number of constitutional amendments to overcome adverse decisions, which by 1957 had already started coming through, and Alexandrowitz was noticing them. Now, in writing this book, Alexandrowitz explained that he'd greatly profited from his conversations with Alladi Krishnaswamy, the Madras lawyer involved in the making of the Constitution. And constitutional developments was largely aimed at Indian lawyers and judges, whom Alexandrowitz regarded as highly irrational in terms of their reluctance to consult the debates. Now, this is really not, in a way, something that out of shyness. It was more out of respect for a British legal doctrine called the exclusionary rule. This rule forbade courts from relying on a statute's legislative history, such as policy documents, white papers, committee reports on the draft bill, and speeches during its consideration in the legislature. Under the exclusionary rule, these background documents surrounding a legislation were considered to be extrinsic to understanding the meaning of a statutory provision. Therefore, in interpreting a law, one had to rely on its actual words and its phrases. You could also use intrinsic aids, like the statute's own punctuation or marginal notes, but you really couldn't look beyond. Now, at independence, Indian courts largely followed the exclusionary rule, and shortly after it opened, our Supreme Court had to examine whether the exclusionary rule also applied to interpreting the Constitution. The underlying case was a fascinating one. It involved A.K. Gopalan, a firebrand Kerala communist leader. The Madras government regarded Gopalan as a dangerous public nuisance, a thorn in their side. He was arrested, but he was not immediately charged with any crime. In other words, he had been preventively detained. That's one of our sort of constitution's birth defects, preventive detention. But Gopalan challenged his arrest in the Supreme Court directly and hired a very interesting sort of choice to be his attorney, who had never really done a constitutional law case, M.K. Nambiar, who argued that his client's arrest violated Article 21 of the new Constitution. Now, according to Article 21, no person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to a procedure established by law. Nambiar told the judges in grand terms that India had modeled Article 21 on the American Constitution's due process provision. Now, interpreting that provision, the US courts had ruled that arrested persons must have an adequate opportunity to defend themselves against charges. Gopalan was unable to meaningfully defend himself against any charges because no one really could explain what crimes he had committed. And consequently, Nambiar argued, his personal liberty under Article 21 had been taken away from him. In response, the Attorney General argued that Gopalan had been validly detained because Article 21 only requires the prescribed legal procedures to be followed. The government in this case had scrupulously followed these procedures, and therefore there was no remedy available to Gopalan. Now, the Attorney General also produced documents from the Constituent Assembly to buttress his case. One of these documents, a report from the Assembly's drafting committee, you can see the actual lines here, revealed that the article as originally framed, a draft article, whatever it was, 15, I think, which became 21, it originally contained the words without due process of law, which was really the American 14th Amendment. But these words were subsequently replaced with the phrase, except according to procedure established by law, in the finally adopted text of Article 21, which I just showed you. Now, in Delhi, it was widely known that this change had been made by our Constitution's draftsman, Sir B.N. Rao, at the advice of U.S. Supreme Court Justice Felix Frankfurter. Frankfurter warned Rao that a due process requirement would lead to ruinous litigation for this new republic. And so instead, Article 21 adopted the phrase procedure established by law from the Japanese Constitution. The hearings went on for days, and in its final verdict, the court rejected Gopalan's petition. It ruled that the legislature had considerable discretion to prescribe what procedures must apply to Gopalan's detention. Fairness of those procedures could not be adjudicated. Now, in arriving at this conclusion, the court was clearly influenced by what had happened at the Assembly. Even so, the judges were very hesitant to openly admit this fact. So Chief Justice Kania basically ruled that where the meaning of a constitutional provision is abundantly clear from its words, there is really no need to look at its drafting history. The Constituent Assembly debates are only helpful if the wording seems vague or ambiguous. His colleagues on the bench, Shastri, Justices Shastri and Mukherjee, they took the view that they reasoned that they could legitimately consult the assembly's debates because these debates reveal the body's collective preferences. But they warned against paying attention to individual member speeches in the assembly. And this early but commonly overlooked distinction is a significant one because it expands our traditional meaning of what constitutes the debates, right? Beyond these thick green volumes, one of which is somewhere here, which are really mostly verbatim transcripts of the assembly's proceedings. And by talking about the reports that accompanied the draft constitution and the other documents, Shastri and Mukherjee in a way sort of diluted a little bit the exclusionary rule, but in a way didn't go formally against it. Now, 2 years later, in a tax case from the erstwhile Travancore Cochin State, Justice Shastri affirmed the importance of the exclusion rule, which he had just diluted at least a little bit in the Gopalan case. He seemed to have shifted his position on the actual use of the Constituent Assembly materials. Interestingly, the rest of the Indian judiciary acquiesces to Shastri's ruling in Travancore Cochin, and the debates are then hardly cited in any judicial opinions through the 50s. In Madras, Alexandrowitz is greatly annoyed by this turn of events. So in Constitutional Developments, Alexandrowitz takes frontal aim against Travancore Cochin. Respectfully but forcefully, he denounces the court for following an antiquated, illogical English practice. Other jurisdictions, including America and France, had long abandoned this antiquated nonsense. And Alexandrowitz questioned whether it was appropriate for Indian courts in a new republic to blindly follow an old colonial practice. Of course, with its critical tone, Constitutional Developments did not really win many fans at the Indian bar. So not a single reported case cites Constitutional Developments' discussion of the exclusionary rule or its paean for judges to look at our constituent debates. Now, interestingly, this sort of ban on courts looking at our debates caused some interesting consequences. Interpreting the Freedom of Trade and Commerce provision, Article 301, before a 9-judge bench in our court this week or last week, in the Atiyabari case, Justice Gajendra Gadkar boldly declares that the Republic's founders wanted to protect the nation's political unity by eliminating barriers to trade among states. Now, the judge did not or could not cite any evidence for this conclusion because of the exclusion rule. And so Gajendra Gadkar's conclusion seems to have been made from whole cloth. Now, of course, this was too much for H.M. Sirvai, the Attorney General, Advocate General of Maharashtra, who was busy writing a massive commentary of the Constitution. So he takes time off from that commentary, write an article published in the Cambridge Law Journal, where he subjects Atiyabari to his trademark withering criticism, especially on this point. How can you impute to the framers a motive without actually looking at the debates? Now, hardly a month before the Atiyabari case judgment is to come down, I think it comes down in September 1960, a young red-haired American graduate student lands in Delhi, August 1960. He was here to study the Indian Constitution's making and as part of his PhD in South Asian history. Some of you were present at my last talk on Austin, and Orgo told me not to mention anything about it. But so let me give you some fresh information, which I did not have last year. Austin was aware that the Constituent Assembly's deliberations had been published in bound volumes even before he set off for India. So before leaving for New Delhi, he searched for them in London and Oxford libraries, but no one seemed to have them, including the High Commission. You can see here the exchange of letters saying, we can't really find this and we're sorry, we can't help you. So he had to come to India without these very basic documents. So Austin was equally stymied for information after he arrived in Delhi. And so he wrote to Prime Minister Nehru. We now have the original letter, which I didn't have last year. And and Nehru clearly has intervened. He also managed to get this fascinating note, which I found 4 days ago, where basically, Prasad invites him over, presumably for tea at 5 p.m. And Austin convinces him to hand over his entire presidential files from the assembly, presidential files in terms of his presidency of the Constituent Assembly, an offer which seems to have caught the president's own staff by surprise. So several decades later, Austin is explicitly warned against asking K.R. Narayanan for any access to his presidential documents before he gets to see him. Now, Austin also obviously sat down members of the assembly. Many of them were still alive, and so took copious notes from those meetings. Obviously, such extraordinary access was a rare one-time event, and he made full use of it. So, after several years, Austin produces a magisterial volume, Indian Constitution, Cornerstone of a Nation. In it, Austin paints a vivid picture of the assembly's members and how they erected a constitutional democracy. It presents an especially compelling account of the debates and the other background documents. Now, it also then proved especially convenient for busy lawyers and judges. No longer did they have to plow through the assembly's stem winders, and there are quite a few of them, for those of you who opened the debates, because also Austin helpfully includes convenient pinpoint citations to the assembly's large volume of debates, documents, and materials, with elegant phrasing that almost seems tailor-made for cutting, copying, and pasting. And many lawyers and judges and scholars, too, readily succumbed to that temptation. Now, Cornerstone's publication also overlapped with the Indian Institute of Public Administration's production of a landmark 5-volume set called The Framing of India's Constitution. And a large editorial team led by B. Shiva Rao assembled and edited this collection. The first volume was a detailed study on key constitutional questions that the assembly had resolved, and the other volumes comprised background documents, official correspondence, committee reports, and other assembly materials, basically a treasure trove of documents besides the debates in the assembly. As Cornerstone and the framing volumes come out, the Supreme Court begins hearing a landmark case. The petitioner, Inder Golaknath and his family hold vast ancestral lands in Jalandhar. These holdings are actually described in successive Punjab gazetteers of yore. You can actually download them. And Golaknath basically alleges that the state government is acquiring the bulk of this inherited property under a state land sealing law, and they are left with only a very small amount to subsist. Golaknath hires Gopalan's lawyer, M.K. Nambiar, to argue his case, and Nambiar asks the court to strike down the Punjab acquisition law. The state government counters that the court has no business reviewing the matter because Parliament had gone to the extent of actually amending the constitution to prevent these judges from reviewing the land sealing law. In response, Golaknath's counsel tells the court that Parliament had exceeded its powers by enacting the constitutional amendments that basically confiscated Golaknath's farmland. And these amendments themselves were invalid as they infringed Golaknath's property rights under the constitution's original text. The judges obviously seemed persuaded by this logic, but they were quite torn about what to do. And in the end, Chief Justice Subba Rao and his 5 colleagues adopt a Solomonic compromise. They decline to strike down the Punjab land sealing law or its protecting constitutional amendments, but they solemnly warn Parliament against further amending any rights under the Constitution. Now, to buttress his reasoning, Justice Subba Rao cites the assembly speeches by Ambedkar and Nehru about the inalienability of fundamental rights. Subba Rao reasons that these speeches by leading constitutional architects clearly demonstrate that Parliament could not abuse its amending powers. Now, he makes, in the same breath, he says, well, I'm not sort of stepping on the toes of the exclusionary rule. I'm not using these speeches to interpret the Constitution. I'm just, putting it out there to tell you what, the spirit of the Constitution is, what the spirit of the provisions intended. In so doing, of course, Subba Rao flatly ignores the exclusionary rule. And so shortly after Golaknath is decided, HMCY finally completes his landmark commentary on the Constitution. And interestingly, although Sirvai criticizes the judges in Atiyabari for not citing relevant assembly documents, his book recommends only very selective use of these documents in constitutional litigation. So to quickly complete the story and set the stage for the next phase, Parliament sort of seeks to override Golaknath through fresh amendments. These amendments emphatically declare that Parliament could change any part of the Constitution, including the fundamental rights, without limitation. And Parliament also grants immunity from judicial review to several other land reform laws and legislations. This sets the stage for another confrontation with the Supreme Court. The Kerala government acquires property belonging to one Keshavananda Bharathi, the head of a Hindu mutt. Bharathi sues Kerala. Palkiwala appears for the petitioners, and he asks the court to invalidate the post-Goloknath amendments for overstepping the lines drawn by Subbarao in Goloknath. He's opposed by Sirvai, who obviously is done with his book, who represents Kerala, who insists that the state had acted lawfully under a state law which the court was in any case powerless to review because of the post-Goloknath amendments. Now, Subbarao and most of his colleagues had since retired from the court, and a largely new crop of 13 judges heard the case. Most of them found that or felt that Goloknath had gone too far by severely restricting Parliament's powers to amend the Constitution. Yet Chief Justice Sikri and his colleagues were disturbed by the prospect that Parliament could amend the Constitution in a manner it pleased. Palkiwala's vivid analogy that the Constitution is not a jellyfish did the trick. Ultimately, a narrow majority of 7 judges ruled that although Parliament enjoys wide latitude over amendments, it could not make changes that would damage the Constitution's basic features. 6 other judges feel no such restriction is necessary, and the case ends there. But if we look at what Justice Sikri wrote in his judgment, which is the only judgment most people read because, you know, it's such a long case, and it's a fairly well-crafted judgment, whether and what to look for in the assembly debates was one of the many issues that the judges considered. And so reviewing previous decisions, Chief Justice Sikri points to Shastri's opinion in Travancore Cochin affirming the rule of exclusion. He too believes that the judges should not use the debates as their primary tool for constitutional interpretation, but he justifies his position using a novel argument. He said that the many princely states that had joined the Union by accepting the Constitution's final text weren't necessarily moved by anyone's speeches in the assembly when they did so. So at the same time, Sikri acknowledges that the debates can be legitimately used to confirm a legal conclusion based on other sources. So it's almost like a backup evidence, which you have to use some other method to sort of establish your conclusion, then you could use this to validate. Now, 2 of Sikri's colleagues, Justices Hegde and Mukherjee, believe that the debates were not particularly helpful in deciding constitutional cases. They want the exclusionary rule to continue. 4 others, Jaganmohan Reddy, Palekar, Khanna, and Matthew, feel that the debates should be consulted if the Constitution is vague. They don't feel it's vague in most cases. And the junior most member of the court, Justice Chandrachud, says flatly no. Despite these divergent views, Keshavananda has been widely read as endorsing the debate's use in constitutional litigation. My friend Manoj is here, and he will correct me, as he's done in all of my previous talks. And after Keshavananda, across the country, lawyers began using the debates when arguing a case. Judges dropped their traditional reluctance to refer to the assembly's proceedings, and eventually the court discarded the rule of exclusion, which has now since been abandoned in England itself. Across the street, or across the city of Delhi, in Parliament, there also seems to be a greater interest in the assembly after most of the assembly members who were in Parliament in a way leave Parliament. The debates begin to be regularly cited, especially during parliamentary debates over constitutional amendments, without the slightest irony, because these amendments obviously reverse what the debates or the decisions of the assembly set out. But outside the courtrooms and the legislature, the general public seems barely aware of the debate's awareness. For several decades, historians, political scientists, and sociologists do not seem to be deeply interested in the Constitution, much less the debate surrounding it. To be sure, those outside the law, though, faced a practical constraint, because aside from Bar Association and High Court libraries, few other libraries stocked a readily accessible or complete set of constitutional documents. In fact, Ramachandra Guha had to wait until he was at Stanford on a sabbatical to consult these volumes, his reliable Bangalore bookseller was unable to procure a full set of the debates, and no local library had a copy. This state of affairs continued well into the 90s, and in fact, when I started law school, our library had a tattered and incomplete set of the Constituent Assembly debates. It did not have a single framing volume, and no one seemed to know how to use them anyway. In a great sign that no one used them, there were no stolen or torn pages from them, which means that they were not widely consulted or in demand. In any case, our professors discouraged us from even mentioning them because they thought this was an archaeological method to study the Constitution. We were constantly reminded that it was the Constitution words that mattered, not its drafting history. However, in recent years, there has been a remarkable resurgence in interest in our constitutional history and the debates, as seen from the IITians' sort of interest in getting me to speak at their group. But what are the reasons that can explain this change in attitude? And I'm sure lots of you have them, and here's some that I've sort of set out, which obviously are not exhaustive. First, as a practical matter, the debates are now more widely available than ever before. For many years, these volumes remained out of print, but as the Constitution's Golden Jubilee approached, the Lok Sabha Secretariat produced new sets using better paper and binding. It subsequently posted an online version on Parliament's website, which of course was initially very hard to use, but has gotten, the quirks have been sort of ironed out a little bit. There have also been private websites, which in a way now also feature the Constituent Assembly debates. And in 2004, the Indian Institute of Public Administration commissioned a fresh edition of the framing volumes, which had last been printed in the 1960s, the ones in red. So these are in a way the core of our constitutional debates, but you know, there are other documents too. But I would venture to speculate as a second reason in terms of growing interest in the debates is B.R. Ambedkar's emergence as a national icon for the following reasons. Dr. Ambedkar was always known as the chairman of the drafting committee, but his much wider role in the assembly's proceedings wasn't particularly well documented, even as not many were even aware of his actual contributions to the constitution making, because he sat as a gatekeeper as each of those amendments were presented. There were very few amendments that passed where he said, "I oppose," and where he accepted an amendment, So basically, most amendments had his approval, which was a fascinating role he played, which is, again, not captured by this idea of chairman of drafting committee, and also the speeches he made to defend each amendment. He was sort of the person who piloted sort of the versions of the draft constitution through the assembly. Now, of course, until in the 1980s, it was largely Dalit intellectuals and activists who studied Ambedkar's work. His biography by Dhananjay Kheer has largely been out of print. But as India's national pantheon expanded, the political elite and wider middle classes grew more interested in Ambedkar, and this rising appreciation for Ambedkar as a constitutionalist is, I submit, a cause or a correlation, I'm not sure which it is, with growing public interest in the debates. Another reason is the rise in interest among social scientists, shedding what Rajiv Bhargav calls a scandalous neglect. Historians and political scientists and sociologists across the spectrum are furiously reimagining the debates and their consequences. I mean, they're really having a lot of fun because this is new material and lots of it which has not been explored. And so besides Rajiv's sort of own thoughtful essays on the subject, to which many others contribute in that volume, Roshna Bajpai has done some superb work on the assembly's handling of minority rights. And of course, in his magisterial work, India After Gandhi, Ram Guha includes what I think is one of the most authoritative sort of summaries of the assembly and its key debates and decisions. Now, interestingly, for years, Austin's Cornerstone was the standard work cited or relied upon even in these sort of secondary analysis of the Republic's founding. That is rapidly changing. James Chirakindranath makes up for Austin's neglect of religion, for instance, a big omission from Cornerstone, and looks at sort of religion in the assembly. Shefali Jha discusses how the assembly designed electoral arrangements even as it worried about its representational legitimacy. And Niraja Gopal Jayal, I think, offers one of the best analyses we have on the assembly's discussions on citizenship, again, a theme not widely discussed by Austin and Cornerstone. of course, this newfound enthusiasm for the debates can sometimes lead to questionable assertions. In argumentative Indian, Amartya Sen suggests that Ashoka and Akbar influenced the constitutional foundations of Indian secularism. But as Ramgu has skillfully pointed out in his review, the debates do not easily substantiate this otherwise attractive claim. I also expect interest in the debates to rise even further with schools across the country using really excellent civics and governance textbooks produced by NCERT. They really explain the Constitution in very simple terms and really make, you know, how it works come alive. What's especially interesting is that these textbooks now not only outline the key structures and principles of government, they introduce the students to the debates with small excerpts from speeches. So this is almost like, you know, I'm sure that, you know, once these students graduate to their IIT and then, you know, sort of have their midlife crisis, they will want to go back and read the debates, just as people who studied in college, you know, the classics like Gibbon and Shakespeare, go back to them in their 50s. So all this means that, you know, the debates are obviously going to be on a lot more people's radar screens. But if I had to go back to this IIT group and tell them why they should be reading it, I thought to myself, well, what am I going to say? Because, you know, six decades later, Alexandrowitz's constitutional developments really still remains a compelling brief for why lawyers and judges must read the debates. So aside from resolving constitutional disputes and helping lawyers and judges help themselves, what other normative and functional value do the debates offer us? So let me offer a few propositions. First, in his typically enlightening piece, Pratap Banu Mehta argues that the debates are the best introduction to India's national political identity. They are among the top 13 books, Pratap says, that he recommends every politician should read. I would say good luck with that, right? But Pratap's point is that any quest to discover the Republic's basic values and high ideals must start with the debates, because they provide the rhetorical underpinnings for what the Supreme Court has called the Constitution's basic features. This is my view, sorry, not his. But the basic features, in a way, if you want to populate that, right, if you want to understand it, or if you want to really give it heft, the debates are, in a way, one of your primary sources. The debates also show the roads taken and not taken in India's Republican journey, which began in May 1946 with the elections to the Constituent Assembly. At the same time, the debates are not our national catechism. They are not a restatement of the common principles of our common constitutional faith. Rather, they represent a sprawling collection of ideas, opinions, proposals, criticisms that were later distilled into the Constitution, and lots of lofty, stirring speeches. But you should also remember there were lots of awful ones too. So we don't want to glorify the debates more than we need to. Now, much of the Assembly's work takes place in great dire settings, and I think we're sometimes apt to forget that, because under the shadow of war and violence, the politics and madness of partition played out before the members' very eyes. Delhi burned, curfew passes were needed. As Austin says, fundamental rights were framed in the carnage of fundamental wrongs. A war had erupted with Pakistan, and an insurgency was underway in several parts of the country. Refugees streamed into Delhi, and the Mahatma was assassinated. So therefore, many members in the Assembly bore witness to these unspeakable acts, and this certainly influenced their views, opinions, and decisions in the Assembly. But it's still hard not to marvel at the magnitude of this achievement, because over the course of 2.5 years, the Assembly adopted a long but modern charter with hardly any guidance from any other post-colonial countries. And most notably, no foreign consultants were involved. This was a charter for Indians by Indians. In that respect, we are also sometimes apt to overlook two of the Assembly's most bold decisions. The first, with one sweep, clean sweep, the Constitution declares an end to centuries of social exclusion and discrimination. This, therefore, I submit, is our very own Emancipation Proclamation. Few other constitutions in the world do so, and, you know, people wondered whether this was really something we should do in Article 17. But there is a certain intertemporal quality to the speeches that were made in the context of this radical provision, which I think are deeply stirring. The second decision that we can't forget is the bold gamble, political gamble, of decreeing universal franchise for all citizens. As Austin explains, it was a leap in the dark. And in the assembly, you could clearly see a lot of disquiet. You know, how do we trust the illiterate masses to basically sustain this democracy? But it was a gamble that paid off, even while it enhanced legitimacy for the Constitution itself. The third reason why I think we should be reading the debates is to explain, besides the sort of debates providing us with patriotic anthologies of theories, concepts, and ideas that I've just talked about, the debates play a lot more of an instrumentalist role. They can help us unravel the true meaning of the more granular architecture, design, and quirks of our modern and modern legal and political institutions, which owe their existence to the Constitution. How is the Elections Commission supposed to work? The Finance Commission? How does the Consolidated Fund of India work? This plumbing and mechanics, which many constitutional scholars dismiss as irrelevant and probably don't even aren't even familiar with them, are just as important as the rest of the grand structural provisions and the rights provisions of our Constitution. Now, I think the debates can also help us understand some constitutional puzzles which recur with predictable frequency. Example, do we have a parliamentary, not a presidential system? Why not? This timeless question, as you've seen in the monograph produced by the Sohn Center, never goes away, it seems, and the debates are the first port of call each time in assembling any answer. And then, of course, the debates can also help fill the silences and gaps in our Constitution, of which there are many, and Alexandrovich alluded to. The fourth reason, in terms of why we need to read the debates, is actually a reason to sort of not take them with the sort of solemnity as we might a holy book. I actually think the Constitution is a holy book, as the Prime Minister says, but it would be a mistake to treat the debates as sort of surrounding Puranas or whatever the analogy is. I don't think he said that anyway, but just as they are recitations of our constitutional faith, the debates provide cold evidence to justify some sacrilege as well. Our founders weren't perfect. They made some really awful mistakes. One ready example, I have to say, is language. The Assembly was acutely conscious. They were warned by people in the Assembly, with TTK, about the consequences of making Hindi the only official language in a vast and diverse country such as ours. Even so, the Assembly went ahead. The Hindi Walas, as Austin calls them, were not restrained, and they voted to embody this gratuitous birth defect into the final text. Now, a remedy had to then be quickly found when the anti-Hindi agitation swept through the South, but the strength of the Union would have been severely compromised had this tension not been speedily resolved. It is indeed ironic, therefore, a future parliament had to correct the Assembly's certitude on the subject, which shows that we should take, therefore, the debates, not as the gospel truth. So the fifth reason why I think, again, we should read the debates is the whole issue of shining a spotlight on the present, in the sense that as much as they shine a light on the past, the debates can considerably enlighten us about the present. Because the founders and framers might see things in our present that we may sort of fail to appreciate ourselves. This is what a political theorist friend of mine calls the presentism of the debates. I have to, you're a PhD, so I have to sound profound. Now, of course, that means that all of us may not share the Assembly's distinctly socialist fervor about centralized planning anymore, but we know from the debates that the founders would scorn upon, the emergence of a Donald Trump, which was the example he gave me. But also, other things in terms of where the sort of debates sort of indicate a broad direction for where the new republic would go. At the same time, it's important to caution that the debates do not provide magical solutions to our current dilemmas. Rather, that they are sort of a rich but non-exclusive historical resource that can help shape contemporary political and policy choices. Now, the sort of the last sort of reason I hesitated to include, it came from a friend of mine, and I thought it was an interesting one which I would test. In his book, Our Declaration, Daniel Allen suggests that the oppressed and disadvantaged groups in America for each generation, blacks, women, gays, directly invoke the language of the Declaration of Independence, the soaring cadences of the Declaration to demand greater constitutional entitlements. And you know, sort of applying that logic here, one could argue that our constitution and its surrounding debates also have an element of enduring appeal to vulnerable groups through the preamble, right, and through the debates. Because after all, the preamble begins with "we the people," and as Justice Breyer points out, they didn't put "we the people" of 1787, or "we didn't put we the people" of 1950, right? So these promises can be invoked by each successive generation of people. And so this is the whole idea of these claims being passed on, you know, textually, where the debates sort of provide the background, because, you know, for instance, there are very stirring speeches on the debates being sort of, on the Constitution being an anti-stigma document. And actually, this argument for equal rights is sort of, at least I noticed in the recently filed Johar case on 377, has a distinctively historical flavor to it, because it seems to tap into this hope expressed in several assembly speeches that social stigma is not permissible under our constitution. And that sentiment is one that's been handed down to each generation that inherits the republic. Finally, the debates are sort of a big resource pool of documents, of material to better understand our founders. The several men members were not exactly household names, but just one look at that raw video feed that from the assembly that we posted last two nights ago on our Facebook page for this event should tell you, just looking at that, that the men and women who were in the assembly represented this country's greatest generation, at least thus far. Right? Some of them were heroes of the freedom movement. Others were active in social movements. This is from a Tea Party for the members of the assembly. Some represented particular groups. Some came from specific territories. They all brought with them a wide cross-section of interests, beliefs, conflicts to the mix. And many of them had serious interpersonal differences with each other, but yet they worked together as a team of rivals. To borrow the American historian Doris Kern Goodwin's phrase, a team of rivals to draft and later adopt the world's longest constitution. Now, I wanted to sort of end by sort of suggesting that in order to fully profit, though, from all this richness and these readings, there are a few basic precautions one must take. And I think this is what I'm going to tell the IITians. First, it's commonly assumed that the assembly's verbatim plenary transcripts are the complete story. This assumption, of course, is wrong. It obscures the fact that the assembly's floor proceedings were carefully choreographed and reproduced in that volume. These do not shed light on the real discussions and deliberations. Why specific articles were drafted in a certain way? Why did the founders choose one option, not the other? For that, one must look elsewhere. As Granville Austen tells us, much of the real negotiations took place outside the chamber. Some matters were even settled through informal deliberations when Patel strolled through Lodhi Gardens. This is actually reenacted in the drama of Samvidhan, which I urge all of you to watch. And many contentious issues were settled in the assembly's several committees, subcommittees, and ad hoc groups that met outside the assembly. We have minutes for most of these confabulations in the framing volumes. We don't know much of what happened in the Congress Assembly Party, which was the party's caucus that met on the sidelines of the assembly. But we have plenty of other stuff to work with, the AICC files, the bulging files in the assembly, all kinds of stuff about who wanted to be in the assembly. The 12 volumes of the transfer of power papers, whose official title is The Constitutional Relations Between Great Britain and India. And add to this mix are the proceedings of the Constituent Assembly when it met in its legislative avatar. No one has fully reconciled those legislative proceedings with the debates in the Assembly proper. And, you know, when the Assembly was meeting as a legislature, they had different presiding officers. They were also doing lots of important things. Now, and then, of course, we can't forget the biographies of founders. There are far more than you think. They're private papers, mostly at Thirumurthy, and oral histories. Again, completely untapped resource. By my reckoning, we have the largest collection of founding documents in the world, and one lifetime is probably too short to read and fully appreciate them in their entirety. Of course, this richness brings complexity, and like there are multiple Gospels in the Bible, there are multiple narratives in the Constituent Assembly's work. Like the Gospels, these narratives can often contradict or even conflict with each other, and so we don't have to forcibly reconcile anything we find in these volumes or pages in the name of founding harmony. These multiple readings of the debates enhance their richness and relevance. This richness is better than privileging particular readings as representing the founding consensus and, by extension, the Constitution's authentic meaning. As the judges in the Gopalan case warned, we can't cherry-pick our way through speeches of the Constitution. Now, I want to end with one final thought. If there's one message I would leave those IITians, it would be to avoid emulating the United States, where founding fathers are worshipped and glorified. Americans worry intensely about what Madison, Hamilton, and Jefferson would have thought of GPS devices, late-term abortions, or violent video games. We have, from time to time, worried about some of the similar sounding concerns, but not to that degree. But we don't have to live and die by what the members thought. In essence, we don't need a Tea Party to have faith in our founders. I end there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vikram, for that wide-ranging and really sweeping talk. I think the only thing that could have done justice to the sweeping debates is perhaps a glimpse of what the debates contained through this talk, which goes over history, law, Supreme Court judgments, and also biographies of different people. I think we've got a bit of time for questions, and I have a few of my own, but because I'm sure there will be many, I'm going to hold back my own and take a few. There's one at the back, there's one here. Yeah. Can we start at the back? Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So I finished my law school last year, and I wrote a thesis on the contributive stature of women in Indian lawmaking. And it's tragic, but all throughout the duration of my law school, as much as we were encouraged to read Constituent Assembly debates, these debates were never ingrained into the syllabus. So I had a tight schedule. So the students really wanted to read these debates and, you know, get a fair grasp over the spirit of the Constitution and get a better understanding, because obviously these you quite dexterously mentioned the significance of these debates. But I think one, and you also mentioned that we have encountered a transformation from these debates being absolutely inaccessible to being slightly accessible now. But I think a present logistical setback that we still face is that these debates have still not been ingrained into the syllabus. So, you know, maybe ensuing interest in historians and sociologists will come at a later stage, but the law students are not really, they don't have a fair grip and grasp, like I said, on these debates, because these are very significant in understanding the trajectory of the Constitution and, you know, how it came into being. So I still don't understand what is the reason behind them not being ingrained into the syllabus.
Thanks very much. Yeah.
I'm Rakesh from the Leh School of Sosha, and my question is, sir, is there any debate or provision in our Constitution to punish under IPC for not implementing affirmative action as guided by Constitution to achieve the goal of equality, liberty and fraternity and justice? If not, then why, sir?
There's a question there. We'll connect with you on that. Yeah, you see, claiming that there were no foreign consultants. In terms of, you see, their physical presence, you see, one can, you see, accept this, you see, as an argument. But can we see, deny or discount altogether, you see, the influence of the liberating, emancipating influence of the foreign ideas?
As we all know, the Constitutional Assembly debates is a sort of product of the happenings of its time. So in that manner of speaking, they cannot think as we are above a limit to think further into the future. In that sense of speaking, I can say that the Constitutional Assembly debates is a document which is temporally static. So how do you think that it can still be used for such new problems that we are facing judicially?
Vikram, you want to take those? And then we'll take this round.
Yes, I'll give short answers. I can be heard.
So on the first question, I mean, there were many points you made, but let me just take one on women in Indian lawmaking. There's actually a fascinating project underway by a woman called Priya Ramachandran. Is that her name? Priya Ramachandran, who basically is looking at the women in the assembly. I'm arguing with her now whether there were 17 or 15 women. But actually, and Austin says there were 9, but there were 15 at least. And it's fascinating because she's putting together biographies of the women founders. And you know, they, even though it's actually interesting, the women in the assembly were the most organized interest group, because in the AICC files you see, you know, they gave a list to Nehru saying here are the women we want elected, and all the PCCs were asked to elect them. And in a way, they coordinated their strategy more than any other group. And so there is a fascinating story to be told, and you know, she's working on it, and I think it would be good if you can join her. On the issue of law students losing interest, I agree. Hopefully, I actually think these books, I wish I had, you know, books like these, and actually these, I think, you know, would rival any civics textbooks around the world. But my friend Rohit Day, who's one of the great historians of constitutionalism, he actually does a role play. He has a reenactment in every constitutional class of his, where he assigns roles to different people in the class. So even if you're bored, or whether you like it or not, you are forced to sort of at least learn, you know, what your who you're acting said in the assembly, right? So that's one possible suggestion. Now, on Rakesh's question on IPC, affirmative action, you know, I wanted to tell you, I forgot, one of the big contributions of Alexandrowitz, who I feel we need to sort of learn more about, because he was actually one of the people who founded, he was the first subaltern in international law. In fact, he founded the school called TWAIL, and which has now lots of adherents. But Professor Bakshi, for instance, is a TWAILer, you know, these are the African and Asian scholars who believe international law represents the status quo, and they want to basically say that it's really a Western-dominated concept. But Alexandrowitz, to go to your question, also coined the term protective discrimination. He was the first person to use that, and not reservation, right? And he felt it should be viewed in that light. Now, about the IPC provision, I don't know, we have Professor M.P. Singh, who's one of the leading constitutional law scholars in the country, so he would be better positioned to answer that question. On the issue of foreign ideas and consultants, I agree. I fully agree. Yeah, you're there. Of course, there were. But, you know, I just look at the countries that I work on now, or where I go, where I see constitutions being written by law firms. I mean, to me, there cannot be anything more scandalous, you know, than that. I went to South Sudan, and I was told very proudly, or at least with great joy, they told me, that they borrowed provisions from the Indian Constitution. So I said, which one? Which are these provisions? And here I expected, you know, I was told the provision was 356. Okay. So now there are, of course, lessons to be learned from abroad, not other lessons to be learned from abroad. And then, as you know, as Hanumantaya, one of the founders from Karnataka, said, we asked, you know, for the music of the Veena and the Sitar, and instead we got the marching of an English band, right? Because he thought this was all such a, you know, old copying from the Government of India Act. But as Dr. Ambedkar himself said, there's nothing wrong to have foreign influences, as he puts it very eloquently in that speech, which I reread this afternoon. There's no copyright or intellectual, patent on constitutional ideas, and to borrow there is to do it as long as it's done deliberately. Because we have lots of examples in our own country of foreign transplants which have taken sort of indigenous roots. But I'm curious to know, though, if there were foreign consultants. I haven't found any. I'm actually curious to know what B.N. Rao did on his trip to Europe, Ireland, and UK. We have most of the notes, but not all of them. And I think you're right, because, you know, I mean, here a Supreme Court justice says don't sort of include this, and here he does it without any going back home and consulting it, right? He just did that, you know. Where was the debate? But also the whole issue of what was the term of the Lok Sabha? Because if you think about our House of Parliament are modeled on the basis of the US Congress, right? Which is why the Senate, the Rajya Sabha is like the Senate in terms of the tenure. The original draft constitution was proposed like the House of Representatives, a 2-year term. Can you imagine the chaos in our country if we had 2 years? And so guess who struck this down? This is President Truman. As you know, B.N. Rao sits down for coffee with him in the White House, which itself is quite amazing that the President of the United States took time to meet the Indian constitutional draftsman. He says, look, if there's one piece of advice I can give you, please don't have every 2 years elections. And he was absolutely right. And then finally, what is the issue on, was the last one more question? Was there?
Yes, a product of its time. Yeah, I'm not sure I fully understood it, but misreadings are part of the creative process. And a constituent assembly or a constitution is a product of its time. But that's sort of the whole reason why I think it would be a mistake and actually it's very interesting you raise this, because there were two slides I didn't have time, because I kept getting all these warning bells from Orgo, of Alexandrowitz. In his later work, he leaves Madras in 1961, and he's obsessed with this with two things. One is to show that really international law has Eastern or sort of non-Western bearings. He thinks that, and it's very interesting. I mean, he's an European scholar who insists that we've ignored Asia, right? So that's one thing. But the other thing he wants to talk about is why lawyers should read history, and he constantly gives the sort of example of how a legal provision or a foundational document must be understood in the light of the historical, the facts sort of prevailing then, but also the time now. And because he has this lovely, word which he says, he says he was fully aware of how the grip of the past might paralyze the present, but then history could confine as well as liberate. And in a way, that's sort of the message he seeks to convey in Constitutional Developments and his other works. So.
I think just to follow up on that, there's a great speech by a former judge of the Court of Appeal in the UK, Justice Stephen Setley, on history and the law, which I strongly recommend, as in why lawyers should read history. Gautam, you had a question. We'll take a second.
My question was, how far back do you think it's going to go in terms of the historical documents? Constitutional text. The reason I ask this is because one of the opinions in the Arunachal judgment just now looks at the Government of India Act 1935 and Hansard debates on, and the House of Commons debates on a provision dealing with the governor's discretionary powers. So, do you think all that is legitimate in understanding our constitution today?
Okay, there's a question here. There's a mic behind you.
You already mentioned that the Constituent Assembly debates were a variety of ideas, and those were distilled when the Constitution actually was enacted. My question is, when judges interpret the Constitution to make a decision, to give a decision, you said that Gopalan case itself said that you cannot cherry pick, but how can the judges make sure that they're not cherry picking exactly and they're not actually being too subjective? So what is the role of the judges in interpreting, using the Constituent Assembly debates to interpret the provision?
I'm Shaurya Upadhyay. I'm a history student and a law student. So my question is that we say that every generation adds to our interpretation of the Constitution, right? And every generation adds to what the Constitution means for itself. To what extent and how do we reconcile constitutional intention, as is imputed by constitutional debates, and how do you go ahead and sort of reconcile them with today's sort of imputation of meaning onto what the Constitution means? How do we, as policymakers, as constitutional scholars, go about that?
We'll be stuck here for a while.
I'm not sure I fully understood that. Can you just explain? No, I may understand. I didn't. Can you give me an example?
All right. So, for example, there was a recent, the judgment on the freedom of the press, right, where we interpreted that the constitutional wordings in themselves are like empty vessels where we sort of, every generation adds to meaning and adds to the meaning of those words and sort of interprets them differently by their own morality and own social standards. How do we go about sort of reconciling constitutional debates and the intention that comes out from the scholars or individual members of the Constituent Assembly, and how do we reconcile that intent with today's morality and today's social standards and how we wish to interpret the Constitution for, as we the people of India? You mentioned that while reading the preamble as well, sir. Thank you so much.
Just speak louder.
All right. So my question is, what is the relevance of the Constitutional Assembly debates on non-law people, especially
lawmakers, legislators, administrators, and the like, and how would this benefit their work?
We have time for one last question. Is there anybody? And then,
How democratic do you think that the assembly was? to what extent were these decisions, we have a lot of these speeches in front of us, but to what extent were the decisions actually being made off stage? And to what extent are the debates, you know, performances that don't actually perhaps carry much weight as far as outcomes concerned?
Yeah, they are very good questions. On the first question about the role of judges in using the assembly, in the Constituent Assembly to interpret a provision, I think there's also a link to your question, Shorje. But basically, I think that, no, actually, you had the first question, Robin. So, but I mean, I'll come to that in a minute. But there is the issue of trying to avoid arbitrariness. And my worry is that the use of, now that the exclusion, I mean, there was a reason for the exclusion rule. It was not like these were all stodgy judges, right? Like there's a rule in contract law called the rule of evidence, I think, right? Which is, says you can't, no, I'm not there. But my point is that there's a reason why this material was disregarded, right? Because, I mean, and historically, we know that in Hansard, members of parliament from Burke's time were paid to say things, right? And so, obviously, you could put anything you want. I mean, that practice, you know, sort of continues today. And which is why judges said, okay, this whole thing is contaminated. And in fact, the original formulation of the exclusion rule in England said that we don't know what the other house said, because at the end of the day, you know, the case would come to the House of Lords, right? So they didn't want to see me sort of basically taking the pulse of the House of Commons. But my big worry, though, is that because of such a mass of documents, 6,000 pages, right, of this alone, plus all the other stuff, you're going to have people sort of, you know, and there are a range of things, and you can find anything you want in this mass. And that, I think, is the danger from discarding the exclusion rule and then saying we should look at the debates, because it's now become very attractive then, you know, to throw in the debates just for fun and, you know, to have some spice in it. And I think that then that leads to serious questions. I think you have given an interview to Live Law or whatever that website is, which basically says that you disagree with the use of the debates in the Arunachal case. I have not read the case as closely as I should to meaningfully comment on it, but I think it's right. I mean, if you say an amendment was voted down and that was the basis for why the governor had or did not have discretion, unless you're sure that that's because, you know, Ambedkar often said, I oppose it, and then sat down. And now members took their cue from it. Now he had reasons in many cases, but, you know, he may not have explained them. But then to infer from just the negative thing, and remember there were about 4,000 amendments, many of them were, you know, sort of done very quickly. So I think that, like all other materials that judges use, right, the same thing can be said about scholarly opinions or foreign precedents, right? We love to look at my argument, for instance, with lots of my younger constitutional law friends, is this craze to bring in, American strict scrutiny and all these great concepts, which I feel has no place in Indian law because we have our own concepts. And so I think there's a responsibility that judges have, and, you know, this just has to be done sort of feeling your way through. But now in Gautam's question, how far you go is an interesting one. I always thought you could go back to the Regulating Act or the Pitts India Act. But, you know, I'll give you an example. Say, I don't practice constitutional law, but I wrote 10 years ago a book on telecom law, and for which I looked at the history of the Telegraph Act. In our Telegraph Act today, there is a section 4A or something, that the actual number has changed, which gives the government an exclusive privilege, right, of working telegraphs. That's the basis for all the licenses, the telecom licenses. Now, that provision actually comes from the 1886 law. So when I looked at the 1886 law, was repealed the 1870 law. The 1870 law repealed the 1860 law, and the 1854 law, that repealed the 1854 law from the East India Company. Guess what? Section 4 wasn't there. So this exclusive privilege today of the central government to operate telegraphs comes from the East India Company's exclusive privilege. Why? Because they didn't want private operators to disturb their monopoly. So if you don't understand, you know, Section 4A today in the Telegraph Act through that historical lens, you're obviously missing something, right? And I think to that extent, you go back as far as you can. And I as long as, of course, you know, the meaning is useful, to get sort of to the end result. Because I have seen many cases, I think in that, 2004, the presidential reference case, there's lots of discussion to all this, stuff from the 1833 Charter Act. And I'm like, okay, so how is it relevant to, you know, the resolving the Constitution? And I think that is also going too far because, you know, you kind of put off people.
and you have to question sort of, you know, such a long dissertation on the use of history. Now, one other question was asked on the relevance of Constituent Assembly debates to non-lawyers. Very, very good question. I actually think, you know, in this respect, first of all, now, Austin has an appendix to his book where he basically lists the 20 leading lights in the assembly, 16 of whom regrettably were lawyers. And some of them may not have practiced law, but still, they had legal training. But I actually think some of the non-lawyers played a significant role. I'll give you an example. T.T. Krishnamachari, who was really a businessman, I don't think he had any legal training. He knew he would get into the assembly. So he decides 5 years before to invest in a library, and he goes around the world collecting books on constitutions, on governments, and he starts reading, educating himself for his eventual role in the assembly. So now I think that, so here's an example of a lawyer, a non-lawyer, who in a way decided that, you know, he would obviously be, didn't want to be intimidated by the lawyers who came there and sort of showed off that legal knowledge. But there are lots of others who really were, you know, powerful advocates in the assembly. I mean, Nehru himself didn't want to be a lawyer anyway, and so, you know, said all these scandalous things about lawyers purloining the constitution. So I don't think that the debates really should, you know, be the province of lawyers. I think these debates are actually accessible enough, just as our constitution itself. You know, I think the greatest tragedy in our country is that we have the constitution is not widely read by non-lawyers. And I think that that's, you know, I think that's where you need to start. And both these documents and the constitution itself should be owned by people, you know, really ordinary people, rather than, you know, sort of, you know, the judges or lawyers in terms of telling you what it means. Was there one more question? How democratic was the assembly? I'm not sure what you meant by that. You meant in terms of the functioning and the procedure in the election, or in terms of the outcomes?
Well, I just mean, you know, you can read the debates and think there's all this great stuff happening, and there's, you know, lots of arguments and things. I just wonder, in terms of actual outcome, to what extent did the debates influence the way the constitution actually looks like?
Well, composition, I mean, look, composition, there was only that much you could do, right? Because in a way, first of all, the elections took place at a time, the Congress Party was sort of, you know, I mean, there was this sort of life and death struggle with the Muslim League. There was a great, you know, no one really knew what the cabinet mission plan had in mind. And if you think about it, 9th of December, 1946, Sonia Gandhi's birthday, on which the assembly actually met, it is true, they both shared the same day. They were actually not supposed to do what they went on to do, right? Because under the cabinet mission plan, they were supposed to immediately adjourn into three groups, right? Which the Congress and the Muslim League accepted. But instead, the assembly went on to frame the objectives resolution, which I think was a kite-flying speech by Nehru, which inflamed the Muslim League, and only two people rose to oppose him, okay, with jeers from the backbenches, Ambedkar and Jaikar, neither of whom really saw eye to eye, right? And Jaikar was sort of, you know, a Hindu right-winger, and Ambedkar was obviously, you know, not yet interested in causing trouble. But they both pointed out, look, you're violating the terms of the cabinet mission plan by, you know, sort of, you know, introducing this highfalutin resolution. I actually think, you know, things went downhill from there in a sense, where basically, you know, you didn't really get the pulse of the assembly. But at the same time, I mean, can you imagine running the assembly with, you know, 300 people deciding their own agendas? Someone had to run the show. And so I think a lot has to be said, and that's why we are eagerly awaiting Arvind Ilangovan's new biography on Sir B.N. Rao, on what his role was, right? Because, you know, for instance, the Gandhians in the assembly were terribly disappointed that this, you know, he drafted a constitution, a Gandhian constitution, and they, you know, Gandhians in the assembly kept writing to Prasad and saying, this is not a Gandhian constitution. And B.N. Rao, every time he raised it, he said, oh, I'm very sorry, but the committee already decided this, right? And so we have to move on. And so, you know, in a way, there was, like bureaucrats today run the show, there was a lot of non-assembly staff probably making decisions. H.B.R. Iyengar was another person. I'm not suggesting that they distorted the will of the assembly, but I think it'd be useful to understand their role. But also the issue of, you know, in terms of democracy, there was only so much you could do in terms of, you know, representing full interests and groups, given the limited franchise with which they were elected. And the assembly members were very conscious of that, right? They kept asking themselves, do we have the authority to make this constitution? And interestingly, today I was reading a debate in 1971, when one of the sort of Goloknath amendments came to Parliament, A.K. Gopalan took the floor and said, we don't regard this constitution as legitimate, and the Constituent Assembly was full of elite bourgeois, okay, who we reject. And guess what? They even introduced an amendment in a private member's bill to have a new constituent assembly. So that disenchantment was always there with the assembly. And as Arvind has pointed out in his Kafila piece, it's often the official histories of the assembly and the making of the constitution, Austin and Shiva Rao, in a way gloss over, right? Because they take the sort of the dominant trend and then present it as the consensus that was then. We know that, you know, it was not so neat and tidy.
So I think when Gopalan might have been talking about elite bourgeois, that might have been an euphemism for lawyers. But hopefully what Vikram's talk today has sought to accomplish is that while the constitution may have primarily been drafted by Indian lawyers, the fact is that the constitution belongs to all of India, and I hope that this encourages people to look at the constituent assembly debates in greater detail, and it becomes a part of everyday life that we have, as the constitution's preamble has today. So ladies and gentlemen, will you join me in thanking Vikram Raghavan? Small token of appreciation for Vikram. Thanks very much for doing this, and we hope to continue this series of talks on legal history, and I hope that many of you will be able to join us. Please keep looking at our Facebook page and Twitter, whatever you call a handle, for this, and thanks very much for coming.